majesty. On the cross you showed your love for me. Beautiful Lord, awesome and mighty, I'm captured by this love I see. Beautiful Lord, tender and holy, your mercy brings me to my knees. It's your mercy that has made me free. Step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see.
Want to be lifted and refreshed, you that turn your radio.
Joyous Radio,
this music brings healing, brings joy and life to the depressed. Oh, keep on.
Hallelujah. Good evening. This is the Christian Family and Choice Radio 92.9 FM. Your life, your salvation, your choice. Invite you to get somebody to right foot and somebody to right on. Let us pray.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, on tonight, once again, it's always an honor and it's always a pleasure to come to your throne of grace and mercy. Father, on tonight, Lord God, we just thank you. Father, on tonight, Lord God, as we go forth with your word, Lord God, we ask you, Father God, for all those who are out there listening, Father God, we thank you for our faithful listeners. We thank you for the brand new listeners, Lord God. And we just thank you, Lord God, for you just being who you say you are, Lord God. We thank you for opening up every ear so the ears shall be attentive, Heavenly Father, unto your words, Father. Once again, Lord God, we take nothing for granted, Lord God. We just thank you, Father God, for 92.9, Lord God. We just are ever more grateful for this station, Lord God. But Father, because so many people can hear about your son, Jesus Christ, the one who died for the remissions of our sins, Lord God, the one who come to give us life and life more abundantly, Lord God, the one who paid the ransom for us, Father, and we thank you. Once again, Lord God, we thank you for Minister Stricker, Lord God. We just thank you for the mighty works that he's doing on this radio station to be able to reach so many people, Lord God, around the entire world so they can hear about Jesus. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for my amazing husband and the man of God on tonight. We thank you, Lord God, for the wisdom, the knowledge, and the revelation that you give him, Lord God, that you would use him to teach your people the truth, Lord God, because you want no one to be destroyed for a lack of knowledge. And once again, Lord, we take nothing for granted. We thank you so much for your everlasting love. We thank you, Lord God, for your word, which is a light and a lamp unto our feet to guide us and to direct us, Heavenly Father, in the way that you want us to go for you. Once again, we thank you for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We thank you for the Alpha and the Omega. We thank you for the beginning and the end, and we just thank you for always being omnipresent, Lord God. We thank you for your love that you have shed abroad in our hearts, Lord God, so we can love one another just as you want us to do. And once again, we just thank you. We magnify you. We glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen. Glory to God. God is still a good God, and the good thing about God being good, he's the same yesterday, today and forever. We thank God for his word that's still alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Thank him for his writing, his Bible. He used the Apostle Paul to tell Timothy, the son in the faith, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God. Timothy, from a child, was known the Holy Scripture, which was able to make thee wise. The early church, the Berean Christians, searched the scriptures out daily to see if these things were so. Solomon, the wisest man of his day, he says the glory of God to conceal a thing is the honor of a king to search it out. So we should do just that. Search it out. He conceal it, let us search it out. As we walk through the Bible in Genesis, he's Joseph, dream, and Jacob, lad, he's our creator. In Exodus, he's the pillar of cloud by day and pillar of fire by night. In Leviticus, he's the Palestinian covenant, the scapegoat. In Numbers, tabernacle. Deuteronomy, he's the apple of the eye. Joshua, scarlet thread. Judges, he's the open furnace. In Ruth, he's the kinsman redeemer. First and Second Samuel, First and Second Kings, he's the God of Israel. First and Second Chronicles, the God of hosts. In Ezra, he's the store of our faith. In Nehemiah, he's the builder of our faith. In Esther, he's our Mordecai. And Job, he's patient. Psalm, he's the poet. Proverbs, he's wisdom. In Ecclesiastes, he's the preacher. Song of Solomon, he's the rose of Sharon, the lily of the valley, prayers of 10,000. In Isaiah, he's the prince of peace. Jeremiah, the balm of Gilead, lamentation. His mercy and compassion endure forever. In Ezekiel, he's the wheel within the wheel, the watchman over Israel. In Daniel, he's the fourth man in the burning fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He's the Ancient of Days, he's Messiah. Hosea, he's God. In Joel, the day of Lord. Amos, he's our burden bearer. Obadiah, servant of the Lord. Jonah is our salvation. Micah is the light to those in darkness. Nahum, a stronghold in their trouble. Habakkuk, he's everlasting God. Zephaniah, he's the day of the Lord. Haggai, he's the Zara of all nations. Zechariah, he's the branch. And Malachi, he's the messenger. Matthew, he's royalty. Mark, he's the servant. Luke, he's the son of man. John, he's the only begotten son. Acts, he's the potter's priest. Romans, he's the greatest. First and Second Corinthians, he's the gift of the Spirit. Galatians, he's the seed of Abraham. Ephesians, the chief cornerstone. Philippians, the name that's above every name. In Colossians, he's the image of the living God, the first begotten of the dead. First and Second Thessalonians, he's hope. First and Second Timothy, he's the bishop of faith. Titus, he's the hope of eternal life. Philemon, he's the bond slave. And Hebrews, the high priest. In James, he's the healer. First and Second Peter, he's the shepherd. First, Second, and Third John, he's love. In Jude, he's the original faith. And Revelation, he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the bright and morning star, the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Advocate, intercessor, mediator, shepherd of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we walk through the Bible, we apologize in advance for walking. We're not standing. We're walking through the Bible. We're not standing. As we move to the book of Revelation, and let's see what God is saying to us. This Revelation, the Apostle John is given credit for writing this book when he started his public ministry. The first set of people that he called into ministry, one of those was John and his brother James. James was beheaded in the process of time by the authorities. John continued with us. He gave us the gospel according to John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and then he gave us the book of Revelation, the Apocalypse. And let's see what God is saying to us there. Get something to write with and something to write on and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Revelation, let's read a few verses from Revelation chapter 1. This is the Apocalypse. And let's see what God is saying to us. Revelation chapter 1. Let's pick it up at verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants the thing which must shortly come to pass, he sent and signified by his angels unto his servant John, who bear record of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ and all the things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth and they that hear the word of the prophecy and keep these things that are written therein, for the time is at hand. John, to the seven churches in Asia Minor, grace unto you and peace from God which is and which is to come, from the seven spirits which is before the throne, from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loveth and washeth all sin in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests unto God his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, they also that pierce him, and all kindred of the earth that wail because of him, even so. Amen. We're going to stop there, and we're going to come in this for a little while. We're going to read those verses again. Notice there's a chain of command up in heaven. Look at verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ which God gave unto him. So God gave it to Jesus Christ. The Father God, Jesus Christ, the third person of the Godhead, then the angels is higher in rank than us, then us, then the body of Christ. Look at that chain of command. Revelation of Jesus Christ which God gave unto him to show unto his servants the thing which will shortly come to pass, he sent and signified by his angels unto his servant John. So from the Father God to Jesus, the third person of the Godhead, then the angels, then the Apostle John, then the body of Christ. Can you see that? Who bear records of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus and all the things that he saw? Blessed is he that readeth and they that hear the words of the prophecy and keep these things that are written therein, for the time is at hand. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from God and from he is, and that which was and that which to come, from the seven spirits which are before the throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and to the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that love us and wash us all sin in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Let's stop there for a little while. Notice here, he made us kings and priests. Look at that fifth verse. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and first begotten of the dead, unto the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that love us and wash us from our own sins in his blood, and hath, that archaic word hath, make us kings and priests. So we are kings and priests. He's king of kings. He's king with a big K, we king with a small K. Ah, we kings, and made us kings and priests unto God his Father, to him be glory forever and ever. Can you see that? Something else he said here. Something else he said here. Look at the fourth verse. Let's chew on that for a little while before we move on. Look at the fourth verse. Look at the fourth verse. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from God, which is, which was, and which is to come, from the seven spirits which is before the throne. Seven spirits. Let's see the book of Ephesians. Let's go to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, seven spirits. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 4, seven spirits. Ephesians chapter 4, let's pick up the fourth verse. There's one body and one spirit, him who is the calling, one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who's above all and through all, and you in all. So we see in here there's only one spirit. Well, somebody, maybe the Apostle John get a wrong revelation, or the Apostle Paul get a wrong revelation. John saying there's seven spirits, and here Paul in the book of Ephesians saying one spirit. Look at the fourth verse. There's one body and one spirit, even with the calling to one hope of your calling. And John says seven spirits. Well, what's he talking about? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The Holy Ghost is not twins. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And let's pick it up at verse 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Let's pick it up at verse 1. Seven spirits, John say in the book of Revelation. Paul say in the book of Ephesians. One spirit, one faith, one baptism, one God, one. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, let's pick it up at verse 1. Get something to write with and something to write on as we walk through the Bible, looking at the book of Revelation. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, let's pick it up at verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried on to these dumb idols, even as you were led. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and no man consider Jesus Lord but by the Holy Ghost. There are diversity of gifts by the same Spirit. There are difference of administration by the same Lord. There are diversity of operation by the same God which worketh all in all. For the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. For the one is given by the Spirit a word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another workings of miracle, to another prophecy, to another discerning of Spirit, to another diverse kinds of tongue, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these work in one of the self-same Spirit, divine to every man severally, as he will. Well, here in the book of Revelation, he said there's seven spirits. Ephesians said there's one Spirit. But what is he talking about here? There's seven manifestation of the Spirit. Yes, but you give us nine manifestation here. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, special faith, healing, miracles, discerning of Spirit, prophecy, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Those are nine. But over there you said there's seven spirits. Is there another discrepancy? No. The Holy Spirit is not twins. Ephesians said there's only one Spirit. Revelation said there are seven spirits of God. Here, we have nine manifestations, and we have seven spirits. Well, tongues and interpretation of tongues equal prophecy. So it's only seven manifestations. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, special faith, healing, miracles, discerning of spirit, prophecy. Seven of them. Tongues and interpretation of tongues equal prophecy. So those seven spirits, those seven manifestations of the spirit, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, special faith, healing, miracles, discerning of spirit, prophecy. Those are seven manifestations of the spirit. Seven spirits of God. There's only one spirit. There's only one Holy Spirit. Amen. Can you see that? Something else he said here in Revelation. Go back to Revelation. Revelation chapter 1. He said something here. Look at verse 5. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness. Notice he's the faithful witness. Not a faithful witness, but the faithful witness. And the first begotten of the dead, unto the prince of the kings of the earth, him that love us and washeth our sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests unto God his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Behold, he cometh with clouds. Every eye shall see him. He come with clouds. What is he talking about? What is he talking about? He come with clouds. Look at Matthew chapter 17. Jesus cometh with clouds. Well, as clouds, as we see it up in the air, clouds are condensed water suspended in the atmosphere. He could be talking about that. Jesus cometh with clouds up in the atmosphere. Couldn't be talking about that. He cometh with clouds and every eye shall see him. First, look at Matthew chapter 17. And let's see if you can break that down. He cometh with clouds and every eye shall see him, and they that pierced him, and all kindred of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. He cometh with clouds. Matthew chapter 17, pick it up at verse 1. He had something to write with and something to write on. Matthew chapter 17, pick it up at verse 1. After 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringing them up into high mountain apart. And there was transfigured before him, and his face did shine as the sun, and the raiment was as white as light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto him, to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make thee three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. While he had spoken, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice came out of the cloud, which said, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. So this couldn't be that cloud that's suspended up in the atmosphere, condensed water suspended up in the air. That couldn't be that. Look at that verse. While he asked me, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice came out of the cloud, which said, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. And let's see what he's saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Matthew chapter 24. I have a Red Lady edition. The head of the church is speaking, and the apostle Matthew is recording. He come with clouds. Matthew 24, let's pick it up at the 29th verse. Matthew chapter 24, let's pick it up at the 29th verse. Immediately after the tribulation, in those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give a light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Then shall appear the signs of the Son of Man in heaven, and all the tribes of the earth shall mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and with great glory. And he shall send his angel with great sound of the trumpet, and they shall gather together the elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. So when he come back with clouds, a cloud and the mount of transfiguration, we see clouds here again. Clouds shall see. Let's see another one. Look at the book of Acts. Acts chapter 1. Clouds. These are special clouds. These are not regular clouds. Acts chapter 1. And let's pick it up. Let's roll into what we want to get into and see what God is saying. Acts chapter 1. Let's pick it up at verse 1. Acts chapter 1. Get somebody to write with and somebody to write on and hear what God is saying to us in his holy written precious words. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 1, pick it up at verse 1. These former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, all that Jesus began to do and to teach, until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Ghost, given commandment unto the apostle whom he had chosen, to whom he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proof, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you shall hear of me. For John truly baptized you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore were come together to ask him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? He said, it is not for you to know the time or the season which the Father put in his own power. But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria unto the uttermost parts of the earth. And when he had thus spoken with them, while they beheld, he was taken up. And what? And a cloud received him. So this Shekinah glory, this heavenly elevator, look at that 9 verse. And when he speak with them, behold, taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven, they went up, and 2 men stood by them in white apparel, which said unto them, you men of Galilee, why stand you up gazing into heaven? The same Jesus which is gone up to you into heaven shall see him come again in like manner as you see him go into heaven. So a cloud take him up into heaven. When he come back at the end time, he say he coming with clouds to pick up his elect. And now he going back after he finished his earthly ministry, spent 40 days with his disciple. Look at that 9 verse. When he has spoken these things, behold, was taken up a cloud. When he mounted Mount of a cloud on the Mount of Trans. Look at 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians. Hallelujah. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Clouds. These are special clouds. Hallelujah. Get something to write when something to write on. Looking at the book of the book of Revelation, the apocalypse, as we walk through the Bible, not standing, we're walking through. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, pick it up at the 13th verse. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, pick it up at the 13th verse and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. But I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them that will sleep in Christ, God will bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Look at the 17th verse. Put your finger on the 17th verse. Look at the 17th verse. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. Clouds again. These clouds are some special clouds. We caught to meet them up in the clouds. Look at something here from the Old Covenant. Look at something in the Old Covenant. Look at the book of Numbers. You got something to write with and something to write. Numbers chapter 12. Numbers chapter 12. We're walking through the Bible in the book of Revelation. Numbers chapter 12. And let's see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Numbers chapter 12. Let's pick it up at verse 1. Numbers chapter 12. Let's pick it up at verse 1. Miriam and Aaron speak against Moses because the Ethiopian woman whom he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman. And they said, had the Lord indeed speak only by Moses, had he not spoken also by us? And the Lord heard it. Now the man Moses was very meek above all men that were upon the face of the earth. And the Lord speaks suddenly unto Moses and unto Aaron and unto Miriam, that they should come out from the tabernacle and the congregation. And the tree came out. And the Lord came down in a what? Like that's the heavenly elevator. And the Lord came down in a pillar of cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle and called Aaron and Miriam, and the both came forth. And said, hear you my words. If there's a prophet among you, I, Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision and speak to him in a dream. My servant Moses is not so. He's faithful in all my house. With him I'll speak mouth to mouth, even apparently not in dark speeches, and in the similitude of the Lord shall behold. Wherefore were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? And the anger of the Lord was kindled against them, and he departed. Look at verse 10. And the cloud departed from the tabernacle. So wherever the cloud go, he's there. So when you see the cloud, he's there. Can you see that? Look at that. And the anger of the Lord kindled against them, and the cloud departed from the tabernacle, and behold, Miriam became leprous and sore. But notice, when the cloud come, he come with the cloud. Maybe he come to pick up Jesus on that book of Acts. He picked him up there. Look at 2 Chronicles, the clouds. These are not condensed water suspended in the atmosphere. This is something else. This is the Shekinah glory. 2 Chronicles, chapter 5, looking at it, walking through the book of Revelation and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written,
precious
words. 2 Chronicles chapter 5, let's pick it up with the 11th verse. That's something to write with and something to write on. Hallelujah. 2 Chronicles chapter 5, let's pick it up with the 11th verse. And it came to pass when the priests were come out of the holy place, for the all priests were with present were sanctified and did wait by course. Also the Levite, which were the singers, and them that were Asaph and Haman and Jeduthun, and their sons and their brethren array in white linen, having their cymbals and their psalteries and the harps to that east end of the altar, and with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. And it came to pass, even as the trumpeters and singers was wont to make one song to be heard, and praising and thanking the Lord, and when they lift up their voice, the trumpet, the cymbals, and the instrument of music, and to praise the Lord, saying, for he is good, his mercy endureth forever. Then the house was filled with what? The house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priest couldn't stand to minister because of, by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of God. So it seemed like the glory of God and the cloud of God is the same thing. Look at that verse again. Go back to the 13 verse. Go back to the 13 verse. I came even to pass as the trumpet and singer was warned to make one song to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lift up their voice, notice not voices, 120 voice, not voices. Everybody at one. With the trumpet and the cymbal, the instrument of music, praising the Lord, saying, for he is good, his mercy endureth forever. And the house was filled with a cloud. Even the house of the Lord was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord. Look at the 14th verse. So that the priest couldn't stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. So the glory and the cloud is the same thing. Can you see that? Go back to the book of Revelation with clouds. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen, amen, and amen. Look at verse 8. Revelation chapter 1. And look at verse 8. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, the Lord which is, which was, and which to come, the Almighty. Now that we can stop writing. That's something for you to go to bed with. Now you can chew on that. I say you can chew on that. I am. Look at the tense. This was spent approximately 2,000 years ago, and he's still I am. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Still I am. That is something nobody else could claim this. Nobody else. Nobody else could claim this. I'm the history of the world. Nobody could claim this. I am Alpha. I before everybody. And I'm Omega. And everything in between. I am Alpha and Omega. The beginning and the ending. It starts with me and go end with me. Nobody else could claim this. Buddha, Hare Krishna, Muhammad. Nobody could claim this. Nobody could claim this. We following a great God. Our God is a great God, Jesus Christ. Look at I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and end. Said the Lord. Said, you tell you who it is saying. It said the Lord. Which is, which was, which is to come Almighty. I, John, am your brother and companion in tribulation in the kingdom of patience of Jesus Christ, was in the Isle of Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Let's stay right there. John was on the island of Patmos for this. But where is Patmos? Where is Patmos? Patmos is a small island in the Aegean Sea between Greece and Turkey, 13 square miles, and they put John there. John was in prison. That's an island prison. They put John in prison. So this letter really is a prison letter. The book of Revelation come when John was incarcerated. He was in prison. Look at that. Look at that verse. I, John, was also your brother and companion in tribulation, and the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ was on the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Well, most of Paul's letters, what he got from prison. Look at something. Keep your marker there. Revelation. Prison letter. The apocalypse. Look at 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. You know, sometimes we worship some places people don't want to worship there because it doesn't smell nice, it doesn't look nice. What kind of environment do you think they have in prison? Yeah, but look at all that revelation you get while he was in prison. And then think about Joseph in federal prison. He working at Potiphar's house. Potiphar's wife told a lie on him, say he tried to rape her, he did rape her. That's what he said. And they put Joseph in federal prison. While in prison, the Spirit of God is working with Joseph. The butler had a dream. And the baker had a dream. and the Spirit of God work in him, and he could interpret the dream for the butler and the baker. He tell the baker he going to be hung, and the butler, you're going to be restored to your position. So that's word of knowledge operating there, that gift, one of those nine gifts of the Spirit operating in prison, while in prison. But what kind of environment do you think you have in prison? And some people don't want to minister in certain places, don't want to go certain because it doesn't look churchy, doesn't sound churchy. Well, where you want to go? Where you want to go? Take your church and bring it to my church. Yeah, you bring your ship to my ship so we could fellowship. You don't need to be in a community with the devil and squad. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all the creatures. The world is those folks out there who say, want a comfortable environment where everybody is safe and everybody is a social club they're looking for. Yeah? Look at this. While Joseph was in federal prison, the gift manifested and he interpreted the dream of the butler and the baker. When the butler was restored, he went to tell Pharaoh, Pharaoh called him out, and while in Pharaoh, interpreted the dream that the Spirit of God is working through him. You just think about that. You just think about it. Look at the Apostle Paul. Look at the Apostle Paul. 2 Corinthians, chapter 11. Glad I came tonight. While I'm cooking, I'm eating. 2 Corinthians, chapter 11. Look at the 23rd verse. 2 Corinthians, chapter 12. Look at the 23rd verse. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more in labor, more abundant, in stripe above measures, in prison, in prison, in prison, more frequent, in debt off. So Paul, a lot of Paul letters came while he was incarcerated. Look at that verse. Look at that 23rd verse. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more in labor, more abundant, in stripe above measures, in prison, more frequent. That letter that Paul wrote to us, the letter to the believers at Ephesus, he wrote that when he was in prison. Paul said, everything I got it by revelation of Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ come and visit him in prison. And you don't want to minister in certain places because it doesn't look churchy. It's better God. God could come anywhere you want to. He could come anywhere he want to. So he visited him in prison. Because look at that letter. That letter was written in prison. More. The letter to the believers at Philippi, that was also a prison letter. Let me see, get out of that. Another one, the letter to those in Colossae, that's also a prison letter. Philemon is also a prison letter. Second, Timothy, Paul about to be headed in some dungeon. He wrote that while there. When Paul ended his life, in his own hired house, they say last 2 years, he had freedom to minister backward and forward. But when he went before Nero, they incarcerated him, they put him in a dungeon. And it's there he wrote that 2 Timothy, telling to bring the cord from its colon in that dungeon. The last 2 years he was in his own hired house, they're paying his rent, he had a rent and had freedom to move backward and forward. But when his first come, he go before the Caesar, before Nero. He had no more freedom. They put him in a dungeon. And it's in that dungeon he wrote that 2 Timothy. The time of my departure is at hand, about to be executed. All men forsake me. All those are prison letters. What's your problem? John on the island of Patmos. John on the island of Patmos. That's an island prison. And he's getting all that information. Look at 2 Timothy. And see what God is saying to us there. 2 Timothy. Chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Paul is writing to his son in the faith. Look what he said. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Let's speak about verse 7. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Paul is in an island prison, Patmos, off the island of Turkey. Small island, 13 square miles. Put him out there. Look what Paul is saying here to his son in faith. 2 Timothy chapter 2, look at verse 7. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ is the seed of David, as raised from the dead according to the gospel. Look at verse 9. Wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. We have to read those verses again. You had to read this verse. The word of God is still quick and powerful and sharp. It worked for Joseph under the old covenant in federal prison. That gift is manifesting there. He could still interpret dreams of the butler and the baker. And many other things. It's work God working with him there. Paul said, I've been in prison frequently, often in prison. Those letters that the believer at Ephesus came from prison. Philippians came from prison. Colossae came from prison. Philemon came from prison. Those are prison letters. Write them while he was incarcerated. And look what he's saying to Timothy. Look what Timothy's saying here. What did he say to Timothy? Look at verse 7. Consider what I say. The Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ, the seed of David, was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds. Yeah, but the word of God is not bound. When you go a little lower down than that, you say this there. When you go to the fourth chapter, yes, he's incarcerated. The fourth chapter. And look at the sixth verse. Now I'm ready to be offered the time of my departure at hand. While he write this, while he was incarcerated. As at hand, I've fought a good fight, I've finished my course, I've kept the faith. Henceforth there is left for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, not to me only, but to all that of them that love him and as a parent. Do thy diligence to come unto me. Come quick. Next time I go up, they may not come back. He first called before the high court. I mean, they may not let him out again. Demas has forsaken me and so on. So bring the carpet and so on. Bring my papers and bring my coat. It's called in this dungeon. Bring my coat for me. Go on to verse 13. The cloak that I have left at Troas with Capis, when thou comest, bring it with thee. And the books, especially the parchment. You're about to be headed, but bring my books for me. Can you read? Those are prison while John was incarcerated. Can you see that? Amen, amen, and amen. Look at something here. Sevens, a lot of sevens. We're seeing here Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1. And look at how many times sevens and sevens and sevens and sevens. Let's look at these things and chew on it for a while. Revelation chapter 1, look at verse 12. I turned to see the voice that speak with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. Seven. Mark how many times you see seven. In the midst of the seven golden stars, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his foot, and girded about with a paps about a golden girdle. His head was as hair was like white like wool and white as snow, and his eyes was flame as fire. And his feet was like unto brass that was burned in the furnace, and his voice was like the sound of many water. And he said, look at that, and he had in his right hand seven stars. Show me times seven, seven, seven. Watch me times seven. Count it, mark it down there. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun that shined in his strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me and said unto me, fear not, for I am the first and the last. Isn't that something? John, when he saw him in glory, he said he fell at his feet as dead. Remember, listen to this. When he started his public ministry, he went by the seaside, he saw John with his father Zebedee. He called him and his brother James. He called Peter and Andrew. And he called Levi and all the others and so on. So then later on, he gave them power to become apostles and so on. It was written right on when he went to the cross and so on. It was with him all the time. And John is the one recorded. We look at that in earlier scripture. He's the one lays head on the Lord's bosom. He lays head on the Lord's bosom. He lays head on the Lord's bosom. The one that he loved. When he was on the cross, he tell his mother, that's going to be a son. He tell his son, that's going to be a mother. So Mary went to stay with John. So he see him, he spent a lot of time with him. But look at it, when he saw him over in glory. Look at it. Look at verse 17. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he lays right hand upon me and said, fear not, for I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I live it forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. Write these things which thou hast seen, the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlestick. The seven stars are the seven angels of the churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. I give my message to give all that. But notice seven, 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 seven all the time. And then, of course, he went to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. He went to the seven churches and gave them seven. Revelation 4. We're walking through the Bible. Revelation chapter 4. Unless what he's saying to us in his holy, new written, precious words, Revelation chapter 4. Look at the fifth verse. Count how many times you see seven this and seven but that and seven this. Everything is seven, seven, seven. Watch that. Mark it out. Revelation chapter 4. Look at verse 5. Out of the throne proceed lightning and thunders and voices, and there came seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Seven. Can you see that? Look at, read that verse again. Out of the throne proceed lightning and thunders and voices, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Seven. Seven. Five. Go over to the fifth chapter. Write it down. Just take your time. We're walking through. Seven. Seven. Revelation chapter 5. Look at verse 1. Revelation chapter 5. Look at verse 1. Revelation chapter 5. Look at verse 1. And I saw in his right hand him that sat on the throne a book written within, and the backside was sealed with seven seals. Seven seals. He had a book in his hand. The one that sat on the throne had a book in his hand and had seven seals. Can you see that? Go down to the sixth verse. And behold, lo, in the midst of the throne of the four beasts, and the midst of the four elders, the Lamb is saying, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. Seven, seven, like we can't get past seven. Seven, seven. Look at that sixth verse again. Get something to write with and something to write on and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Seven, seven, seven. Got six. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and the four beasts and the midst of the elders stood a lamb as one had been slain with seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. Seven manifestation and into all the earth. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 8. Looking at the sevens. We're looking at the sevens. Get something to write with and something to write on. Hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Revelation chapter 8. Look at verses 1 and 2. When he had opened the seven seals, there was silence in him about the space of a half an hour. And I saw the seven angels standing before him, before God, and there was given to them seven trumpets. Seven, what do you say, 7 days and seven that? I hope you count and mark them down. Let's go back to look at those two verses again. Seven. And when he had opened the seven seals, there was silence in heaven about the space of a half an hour. And I saw seven angels which stood before God, and to them was given seven trumpets. Seven, 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 seven. 10. Revelation chapter 10. We're looking at the sevens. I'm saying everything because we're walking through. We're looking at some of the sevens. Revelation chapter 10. Pick it up at verse 1. Revelation, we're walking through the Bible, looking at the book of Revelation, and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Revelation chapter 10. Pick it up at verse 1. And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with the clouds, and a rainbow hung about his head, and his face was as the sun, and his feet was the pillars of fire. And he had in his hand a little book open, and he set the right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon the earth. And he cried with a loud voice, the lion roared, and he had to cry the seven thunders, or the seven voices of seven thunders. We have to read those verses again. Seven thunders. You see, like thunders could speak. Thunders of personality. I saw another mighty, go back to the verse one. I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with the clouds, and a rainbow round about his head, and his face was the sun, and his feet was pillars of fire. And he had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon the earth, and he cried with a loud voice, like a lion roared. And when he had cried, seven thunders utter their voices. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 12. We're looking at some sevens. Seven thunders, seven angels, seven spirits, seven this, seven that, seven, 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 seven. Revelation chapter 12. Get something to write with and something to write on and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Revelation chapter 12, pick it up at verse 1. There appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head were crowns of 12 stars. And she bring with her a child, travailing birth, and pain of delivered. And there appear another wonder in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head. Something else. That's the other side. We're going to get to that when we get to that. Amen. Amen and amen. Revelation chapter 13. We're looking at some sevens. And hear what God has said to us in his holy, written, precious words. Revelation chapter 13. Look at verse 1. All these different sevens. Revelation chapter 13, look at verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns were 10 crowns, and upon his head the name blasphemy, and so on and so forth. 7. Look at 15. Revelation chapter 15. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 15. And let's see what God is saying to us. Look at this. Look at verse 1. Revelation chapter 15. Look at verse 1. And I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, 7 angels having the 7 last plagues, and in them was full of the wrath of God. Isn't that something? The wrath of God. Whatever happened to God is love. I know. The severity of God and the goodness of God. Very good on this side and something else on that side. The goodness of God and the severity of God. Look at that. Revelation 15 and look at verse 1. I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous. 7 angels having the 7 last plagues, and in them filled the wrath of God. So up in heaven have plagues. How you like that? Well, let's see some other 7 before we close this segment. Go back to Revelation chapter 1 and look at the visions. John had 7, all this taking place on the island. They put John there, he died in that island. Never let him off that island prison. But all this time, think about the amount of time that Jesus Christ, the head of the church, visited. Think about the apostle Paul and those prison letters God visited. You just think about that. God could meet you wherever you are. Look at his vision. He had 7 visions. 7 different visions. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 1. You see some of the visions that Paul had, that John had. The love apostle. Old man on the island of Patmos. Revelation chapter 1, and he had this vision while he was there on the island of Patmos. Revelation chapter 1, pick up at verse 10. First, look at this vision. I was in the spirit on the Lord then, and I heard behind me a great voice as a trumpet saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book and send unto the 7 churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, unto Smyrna, unto Pergamos, unto Thyatira, unto Sardis, unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. And I turned to see. Now this is a gift in operation. This is discerning a spirit in operation. Every time John will see, he see. Revelation. There are 3 revelation gifts. The 9 gifts are divided into 3 parts. 3 of them say something. The gifts of utterance, prophecy, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. They say something. Then you have the revelation gift, word of knowledge, word of wisdom, and discerning a spirit. He had discerning a spirit. He saw these things on the island of Patmos. These gifts manifesting there on the island. 3 of them do something. Workings of miracles and special faith and gifts of healing, they do something. Look at this here. While on the island there, he saw, look at this, having this vision on the island here. 7 different visions he had. Gave us this book of Revelation. God appeared to him 7 different times and gave him all this information. I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice as a trumpet saying unto me, I'm Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book and send unto the 7 churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, unto Smyrna, unto Pergamos, unto Thyatira, unto Sardis, unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. And I turned to see the voice that speak with me. And being turned, I saw 7 golden candlesticks, and so on and so on. In the midst of them, he saw the Lord a vision. Look at the next one he saw. Revelation chapter 4. And see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word. As we walk through the Bible, look in the book of Revelation, the Apocalypse, and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word. The Apostle John, the love apostle. Revelation chapter 4. Not a vision. After this, so he saw that first one, he got all that information to send to the church of Asia Minor, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. After this, another vision. Look at chapter 4, verse 1. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard, which was the trumpet talking to me, said, "Come up hither, and I'll show thee things which must be hereafter." And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat in the throne. So this is another vision. After this, I saw another one. Give him all this information, and he went up and he squatted up there. Can you see that? Well, let's see some of the things that he saw when he went up into heaven. Let's see some of the things that he saw when he went up into heaven. Second vision. Look at this. Let's read those verses again. He went up into the third heaven. Paul said, "I know a man in Christ about 14 years, but in the body I cannot tell, but out of the body I cannot tell. Such a one was caught up into the third heaven. Whether in the body I cannot tell, but out of the body I cannot tell. Such a one was caught up into paradise." So there's a third heaven where Almighty God is sitting. There's a second heaven called the heavenlies. He was caught up into the third heaven. Look what he saw when he went up there. Revelation chapter 4. Let's speak about verse 1. After this, look, and behold, a door was open in heaven. And the first verse which I heard as the word of the trumpet talking to me, which said unto me, "Come up hither, and I'll show thee things which will be hereafter." And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat was looked upon like jasper and a sardine stone. There was a rainbow round about the throne, like unto emerald. Round about the throne there was 24 seats, and upon the seat I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed with white raiment, and there was all their heads was crowns of gold. Out of the throne proceed lightning and thunder and voices, and there were 7 lamps of fire before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. Before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal, and in the midst of the throne, around about the throne, there were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. The first beast was like unto a lion, the second beast was like unto a calf, the third beast was like unto a man, and the fourth beast was like unto a flying eagle. And the 4 beasts, each of them had 6 wings about them, and they're full of eyes within, and they rest not night and day, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was, which is, and which is to come." Which when it, and when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks unto him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fell down before the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever, cast down their crowns before the throne, saying, "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor, power. Thou hast created all things, that for thy pleasure are they and were created." Quite a bit distant. So he saw a scene when he went up there. Now Ezekiel, when he went up into heaven, he said, "You see a 4-faced man." He see a 1 man with 4 faces. Well, 1 man with 4 faces, 4 different creatures. John saw it right. Remember that Ezekiel was a prophet and John was an apostle. God set up in the church, first apostle, secondary prophet, thirdly teachers. After that, he gave the work of the evangelist, then the pastor. So the apostle is higher ministry gift than the prophet. And then a prophet under the old covenant was not saved. They had the Spirit of God upon them to stand in that office. Only 3 people in the old covenant had the Spirit of God upon them: the prophet, the priest, and the king. Nobody else had it. That's it. And Ezekiel said one time, "The hand of the Lord was upon him," meaning the anointing was upon him. And next time he said, "The hand of the Lord was upon me heavy." So he was drunk in the spirit. The day of Pentecost, when the people laughed at the day of Pentecost, said, "These men are full of new wine, they're drunk." Peter said, "They're not drunk as you suppose. They're drunk, but not the way you suppose." So he drunk, and the spirit is seen 1 man with 4 faces. A 4-faced man of a lion and a calf at one side, a man and an eagle at one side. He said, "A 4-faced man." He was drunk. And you see that? John saw the writing here.
John, full of the Holy Spirit, higher ministry gift, give it better here. Huh? He said, Peter said, the day of Pentecost, yes, they're drunk. It's true, they're drunk, but not as you supposed they're drunk. The hand of the Lord was heavy upon Ezekiel, and he seen this four-faced man. The man have four faces. No, four faces, the four creature. Because when you get to the book, look at, keep your marker there. Keep your marker there, we're going back there. We didn't finish yet. Get somebody to write, when somebody to write on. We're not finished that yet, go back there. Look at the book of Isaiah. I don't know why people don't like to read their Bible. Something is wrong with Christians who don't like to read their Bible. Lazy. Something is wrong with you. Lazy. Isaiah chapter 6. And let's pick it up at verse 1. Isaiah chapter 6. Let's pick it up at verse 1. Yeah, I know four-faced man is four different creatures. But he was drunk. So he's seen one man with four faces. Drunk in the spirit. Isaiah chapter 6, look at verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train filled the temple. And above stood the seraphim, each one had six wings. With twain they covered their face, with twain they covered their feet, with twain they did fly. And one cried unto the other, saying, Holy, 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 the Lord of hosts, who is full of glory. And the post of the door was moved, and the voice, and the cry, and the house was filled with the smoke. So he's saying he saw these different seraphims up there, look at it. They stood up, look at that. Look at verse 2. Above stood the seraphims with an S. Each one had six wings and they covered their faces. So you see these seraphims up there. Each one was different. He didn't give the describe the way John described it. Ezekiel said four-faced man. And Paul said the best thing. When I was up there, I saw things that were unspeakable. Can't speak it. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon his throne, high and lifted up, and the train was full of temple. And round about was seraphims, stood seraphim. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered when they did fly. And one cried to the other, saying, Holy, holy, holy. Well, the same thing that John said, was saying there, holy, holy, they're saying up there. And cried one to another. And the post of the door was moved, the voice of him that cried, the house was filled with smoke. So let's go back over here when he arrived, what he saw up there. Revelation. Chapter 4, let's see what he saw when he arrived up there. John was caught up in the third heaven, and they gave him a tour. He spent quite a bit of time up there in the second vision. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was the trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I'll show thee things that might be hereafter. So he was getting a word of wisdom to things to come. God, they're going to put Satan and put him in bottomless pit. That hadn't happened yet, so he was looking at things to come. Immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat on the throne looked upon like a jasper and a sardine. So what is that? He can't explain it. It's undescribable. You see, Paul said right. Saw things that is unspeakable. He never seen nothing that he could compare it with. So he's saying sardine and tapu, topaz stone. What is that? Nothing. And he that sat was look upon a jasper and a sardine stone, and they were round about the throne, the side like unto emerald. And round about the throne there was 420 seats, and upon the seats I saw 420 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their head crowns of gold. Out of the throne proceed lightning and thunders and voices, and there were the seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal, and in the midst of the throne, round about the throne, there was four beasts full of eyes before and behind. You see, eyes, that's how about these beasts up there. First beast was like unto a lion. The second beast was like unto a calf. The third beast had the face of a man. And the fourth had the face of a flying eagle. And these four beasts, each one had six wings. Isaiah saw that. With two or twain they covered their face. Two or twain they covered their feet. Two or twain they did fly. Each of these beasts had six wings. These are seraphims. It seemed like seraphims only step in heaven around the throne. It seemed like that cherubims move up and down. But seraphims seemed to step in there and return heaven. These four beasts, each one had six wings about him. And they were filled of eyes within. They rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which is to come. When these beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, he that liveth forever and ever, the 420 elders fall down before the throne, before him that sat on the throne, and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power, for thou hast created all things. Now we could stop writing. Thou hast created all things. Well, if you follow anybody else, they didn't create it. Whoever you follow, God created. Because if my God created all things, so if you follow anybody that is not our God, my God created him or her. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, 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 for thy pleasure are they and were they created. Vision. Revelation chapter 7, next vision. Hallelujah. Next vision. Glory to God. Seven visions. God appeared to him on the island of Patmos in prison. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 7. Look at verses 1 and 2. After these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, and the wind should not blow on the earth, nor the sea, nor anything. And I saw another angel ascending out of the sea, having the seal of the living God, and cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to her, the earth and the sea. I saw, and this is another vision. I said, this is another vision, not the same one. After these things, I saw four angels. Another one. Let's see if we can cover another one. Revelation chapter 10. Another vision. Hallelujah. Revelation 10. Look at verse 1. And I saw another mighty angel. Another one. Give him another one. Finish that vision. Give him another one. Huh? I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud and a rainbow round about his head, and his face was as the sun and his feet as the sun. And he had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon the earth. So, another one. Revelation 12. Glory to God. God is still a good God, and we thank him for his holy, written, precious words. Get some of the right feet and some of the right, and while I'm cooking, I'm eating. Revelation chapter 12. Look at verses 1 and 2. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head the crowns of 12 stars, and bring down the child that cried with travail in birth and pain to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great dragon having 7 horns and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head, and his tail grew 1/3 of the stars of heaven. So another vision. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 15. Visions. Visions, anytime a person having visions, that's discerning a spirit. That's a spiritual gift in operation. Discerning a spirit. Discerning means to see into or to see through the realm of the spirit. That's what discerning a spirit means. To see in the realm of the spirit. Paul Peter had that, he fell in a trance and he looked into the realm. He's discerning a spirit. Paul also had that, he fell into a trance and he's seeing in the realm of the spirit. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 15. Another vision. On the island of Patmos. Glory to God. Revelation chapter 15, look at verse 1. I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, 7 angels having the 7 last plagues, and them were filled up with the wrath, and I saw as were the sea of glass mingled with fire, and in them had gotten the victory over the beast, and over the image, and over the mark, over the number of his name, stand in the sea of glass having the harp, and I sing unto the song of Moses and Saul. Another one. Let's see another one. Let's see the last one. Revelation chapter 18. I'm glad I came tonight. While I'm cooking, I'm eating. God is still a good God, and we thank him for his holy, written, precious word. Revelation chapter 18, look at verse 1. After these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having a great power on the earth, and lightning upon his feet, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and so on, and so on, and so on. Revelation. As we walk through the Bible in Genesis, he's Joseph's dream and Jacob lad, he's our creator. Exodus, he's the pillar of cloud by day and pillar of fire by night. Leviticus, he's the Palestinian covenant, the scapegoat. Numbers, the tabernacle. Deuteronomy, he's the apple of the eye. Joshua, scarlet thread. Judges, the jawbone of an ass. In Ruth, he's the kinsman redeemer. First and second Samuel, first and second Kings, he's the God of Israel. First and second Chronicles, the God of hosts. In Ezra, he's star of our faith. Nehemiah, he's the builder of our faith. Esther, he's our Mordecai. And Job, he's patient. Psalm, he's the poet. Proverbs, he's wisdom. And Ecclesiastes, he's the preacher. The Song of Solomon. The Rose of Sharon, the Lily, the Valley, Prayers of 10,000 in Isaiah, he's the Prince of Peace. Jeremiah, the Balm of Gilead, Lamentation, his mercy and compassion endure forever. In Ezekiel, he's the wheel within the wheel, the watchman over Israel. In Daniel, he's the fourth man in the burning fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He's Ancient of Days, he's Messiah. Hosea is God. Joel is the day of the Lord. Amos, he's our burden bearer. Obadiah, he's servant of the Lord. Jonah is our salvation. Micah, he's the light to those in darkness. Nahum, a stronghold in their trouble. Habakkuk, he's everlasting God. Zephaniah, the day of the Lord. Haggai,
His desire for all nations. Zechariah is the branch, and Malachi is the messenger. Matthew, his royalty. Mark, his servant. Luke, he's the son of man. John, he's the only begotten son. Acts, he's the power of spirit. Romans, his grace. 1 and 2 Corinthians, he's the gifts of the spirit. Galatians, he's seed of Abraham. Ephesians, the chief cornerstone. Philippians, the name is above every name. In Colossians, he's the image of the living God, the first begotten of the dead. 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he's hope. 1 and 2 Timothy, he's the bishop of faith. Titus, he's the hope of eternal life. Philemon, he's the bond slave. And Hebrews, the high priest. James is the healer. 1 and 2 Peter is the shepherd. 1, 2, and 3 John is love. And Jude is the original faith and revelation. It's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the bright and morning star, the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Advocate, intercessor, mediator, shepherd, and Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. As we walk through the Bible, Revelation chapter 5, we're walking through, we're not standing, get something to write with, and something to write on and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Revelation chapter 5, and let's speak about verse 1. Revelation chapter 5, and verse 1. And I saw the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within, on the backside a seal with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? And no man in heaven, nor in earth, nor under the earth was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open or to read the book, neither to look thereon. Isn't that something? Where is your leader? Where is your leader? How come he couldn't read it? I wept, John said, you wept bitterly. Look at verse 4. And I wept much, because no man, black man, white man, male man, female man, young man, rich man, poor man, educated man, uneducated man, no man. Can you read? I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. Look at verse 5. One of the elders said unto me, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. That is something. One person. Planet Earth have over 7 billion people in it. Nobody could open it. Only one person. Father God gave him the seals, and he opened that book, and he started looking into that book first. Nobody could open it. Look at that. We're going to read those verses again. Nobody. Almighty God have this book with a seal in it, and nobody in heaven on earth or under the earth could look in that book. Isn't that something? Boy, we're following a great leader. Mighty God. Mighty God. Nobody. Nobody. None of the continents in Asia, in Africa, in Europe, in the Americas, nowhere could open this book. 7 billion people, nobody. Only Jesus Christ. Only Jesus Christ. Only Jesus Christ. I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the side a seal of seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who's worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? And no man in heaven nor in earth, neither under the earth, were able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. Can't even look at the book. I didn't want to look at the book. Verse 5. One of the elders said unto me, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And I was so glad. Behold, lo, in the midst of the throne, and so on and so on. But one was found worthy to open the book. Let's go over to the 6th chapter. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Amen and amen. Go over to the 6th chapter. Verse 1. And I saw when the Lamb had opened the book, one of the seals, I heard as it were the noise of thunders, and one of the four beasts saying, come and see. Now notice who is opening the book. Nobody was found worthy to open the book. Only the Lamb opened the book. Look at verse 2. And I saw, behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him was had a bow, and a crown was given to him. He went forth conquering and to conquer. Well, many people think that's us. That's not us. That's that other side. That's that false church. Look at it. Well, does what do a conqueror do? He had to conquer us because he may be in a battle to get us from God, to drag us into hell. I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, I heard as it were the noise of thunders, one of the four beasts saying, come and see. This is our side. Jesus opened the seal, and one of the beasts said, come and see.
So John now looking at the book, seeing what is seen behind the seal. What he saw? And I saw, behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him. And he went forth conquering and to conquer. Went forth conquering and to conquer. But what does it mean to conquer? To overcome or to subdue by force, as in war. To gain control of, to be victorious over, to overcome physically, mentally, or morally, to surmount. He went forth conquering. Now notice, this is the white horse. And they did give a proper noun. They give a pronoun. He. Can you read? How read is that? He. Let's read it first again. Look at it. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat and had a bow and a crown was given unto him. Not a proper noun, but a pronoun. He. He went forth conquering and to conquer. Well, who is that? Look at Matthew. Chapter 7. You had somebody to write with and somebody to write on. Hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Matthew chapter 7. Look what Jesus said to us. Yeah, white horse, I know. Take it on to Johnstown, Guyana. Yeah, free food, fresh air, fresh vegetable. No police, no crime. No pollution, I know. White horse. White horse, I know. Hallelujah. But notice, Jesus is the one opened the seal. And the angel tell John, come on, look and see. Look. Look at deception. White horse. Dressed up like a man of God. Yeah, white horse. Waco, Texas. Heaven Gate, Carlton, California. Johnstown, Guyana. White horse. Look at it. Matthew chapter 7. Pick up the 15th verse. White horse. To surmount, to overcome. Physical, mental, or moral. Look at it. Matthew chapter 7, pick up the 15th verse. Beware of false prophet which come to you in sheep clothing, white horse. Inwardly they're ravening wolves. You shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorn or figs of thistle? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruits. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruits, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruits. Every tree bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast in the fire. Yeah, see what happens to your son, Guyana? White horse. White horse. Wherefore, by the fruits, you shall know them. Look at what he said in verse 15. Beware of false prophets which come to you. Sheep clothing. Yeah, dress up. Yeah. White horse. Riding a white horse. Look at the next one. Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. All the time throughout, deception. Conquering and to conquer. Take you by force. Matthew chapter 24. Look at verses 4 and 5. Jesus speaking. I have a red light edition. The head of the church is speaking. The apostle Matthew is recording. Matthew 24. Look at verses 4 and 5. Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. Many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Yeah, riding a white horse. Many shall come. Look at it. Jesus answered and said, take heed that no man deceive you. Take heed. For many will come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Go down to verse 11. Look at the 11th verse. Look at the 11th verse. Many false prophets shall arise, and shall deceive how many? How many is many? Go down to the 24th verse. Go down to the 24th verse. 24th verse. Jesus opened the seal. The angel tell John, come and see, look. See, look. One coming riding a white horse. Look at verse 24. There shall arise false Christ and false prophet, and shall show great signs and wonder, insomuch if it were possible, they deceived the very elect. Not just signs, but great signs. I have a red light edition. The head of the church is speaking. Apostle Matthew's recorded. God had set some in the church, first apostles, highest ministry gift. Look at that 24th verse. There shall arise false Christ and false prophet, and shall show great signs and wonder. If it were possible, they deceive the very elect. The very elect. 2 Corinthians 2 Corinthians chapter 11, the white horse. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, get something to write with and something to write on. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, look at the 13th verse. For such a false apostle, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. No marvel that Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Into an angel of light. Transform into an angel of light. Therefore, it's no great thing if his ministers also are transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Transform. Transform. Look at those verses again. Look at those verses again. Look at those verses. Look at verse 13. For such a false apostle, deceitful workers. Yeah, they're working all right. They come to conquer, and to conquer. Go forth to conquer, conquering and to conquer. For such a false apostle, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostle of Christ. It's no marvel that Satan himself is transforming into angel life. Therefore, it's no great thing if his ministers also are transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. 1 Thessalonians. Yeah, the white horse. Come and see, look. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. No man worthy to open the book. Open the book. First seal. Seven seals. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Look at verse 1. But of the time and the season, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. You yourself know perfectly that the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, when they shall say unto you, peace and safety, suddenly destruction shall come upon them as travel as a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, be not in darkness as they that overtaken and should be overtaken as a thief. But you are children of light and children of day, not as night of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep are sleep in the night. They that are drunk are drunk in the night. Let us all, if one day sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, the helmet of hope and salvation. For God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, white horse comes, suddenly destruction comes. Look at it, go back up to verse 1. But the time and the season, brethren, you have no need that I write to you. For you yourself know perfectly that the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. Least expect, yes, keep praying, searching all the things of God. It's the glory of God to conceal a thing, but it's the honor of a king to search it out. Now look at our white horse. Look at Revelation chapter 19. Look at our white horse. Revelation 19. Look at our white horse. Hallelujah. Look at the difference in our white horse. Hallelujah. Revelation 19. Look at the 11th verse. Look at the 11th verse. This is our white horse. Look at it. And I saw heaven open. Heaven. Heaven. Everybody say heaven. Heaven open. Behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon it was called faithful and true. And righteousness do he judge and make war. His eyes was the flame of fire. And his head was the many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven follow him upon white horses, clothed in white linen, and white and clean. Out of his mouth goeth forth sharp sword, and with he should smite the nations that rule them with a rod of iron, and tread upon the winepress of fierce and the wrath of the Almighty. And he had a vesture on his thighs was written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's us. So you see our white horse, notice the difference. I saw in heaven. Now when you look at their white horse, go back, keep your marker between these two. Keep your marker there. You have all these fingers. Use it. Some people got no hands. You got your hands. Use it. Lazy. Now look. Go back. Look at, keep your marker between the two of them, between Revelation 6 and 19. Look at Revelation 6 again. And I saw the Lamb open one of the seal, and heard a voice of noise of thunders, and one of the four beasts said, come and see, telling John, come and see. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him had a bow and a crown upon, and a bow and a crown was given unto him, he went forth conquering and to conquer. Now go over to our own Revelation 19, verse 11. I saw heaven open, and behold a white horse, and he that sat upon it was called Faithful and True. Righteousness do he judge and make war. His eyes was the flame of fire. Did we saw that earlier on? And his head was many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed in vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Hallelujah. Let's see the second one. Glory to God. Look at the third verse. Revelation chapter 6. Look at verse 3. You have something to write with? Something to write on. See what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious. Look at the third verse. When he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. And when it went to another horse, look at it, and it went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat upon it to take peace from the earth, and should kill one another. They should be given unto him a great sword. So this one here is a red horse. Well, this is war. You see, after the white horse, now come the red horse. Look at it. There went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him. Who gave him this power? Who gave him this power? Power was given to him. Look at this. It went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat upon it to take peace from the earth. Well, if there's no peace, there's war, that he should kill one another, and was given to him a great sword. Well, who gave him this power? Look at Revelation 13. Look at Revelation 13. Look at Revelation chapter 13. Hallelujah, Revelation chapter 13. Let's read a few verses, not all of it. Revelation chapter 13, we're walking, we're not standing, we're walking. Revelation chapter 13. And verse 1, and stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 head and 10 horns. And upon his 10 crowns, and upon his head was the name Blasphemy. Well, you know that's on the other side. And the beast I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet was like the feet of a bear, and his mouth was the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him power, and his seat, and great authority. Well, who is the dragon? Satan. So Satan gave him this power. Remember, we described this man in another reading, another setting here. This person, whoever it is, at least have a lot of, I mean, very wise person in wisdom of this world, of course. They have the wisdom from heaven and wisdom of this world. Now look at this. Watch this. Look at his writing here. Look at verse 1. I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise about the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns. Well, 7 heads mean he have universal wisdom, and 10 crowns mean he have absolute power. He have a sort of united nation control on other countries. So he have that upon his head, the name Blasphemy. And the beast that I saw was like unto a leopard. Tell him what this man is like. What kind of person is that? What kind of animal is a leopard? Very savage type animal. And his feet was the feet of a bear. Or what's the correction of a bear? He eat every day his part. And he had the mouth of a lion. Oh, what about a lion? He's king. He's king of the jungle. King of so this is the man, absolute power, very wise. Very savage type person. Look at it. They stood upon the sand of the sea. I saw a beast rise out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his head was the name Blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard. It was a savage type animal. And his feet was like the feet of a bear. Eat everything, anything is bad, he'd eat. Scorched. And his mouth is the mouth of a lion. And the dragon. The dragon gave him power. Now look at something in the book of Ezekiel. Look at something in the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel 28. Keep your marker there. Ezekiel 28. Look at a picture of it. Look at a picture of it. Now the dragon, Satan, gave power to the beast. Look at this. Ezekiel 28, get somebody to write with and somebody to write on. Open the second seal, red, blood, war. Ezekiel 28, pick it up at verse 1. The word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, Thus said the Lord, because thou hast was lifted up, thou hast said, I am God, and I sit in the seat of God, in the midst of thee, yet thou art a man, and not God, though thou hast sat as the heart of God. Behold, thou art wiser than Daniel, thou art wiser than Daniel. Now this is from that kingdom of darkness. Thou art wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that can hide from thee. With thy wisdom and with thy understanding, thou hast gotten the riches. Thou hast gotten gold and silver into thy treasure. By thy great wisdom, thou hast trafficked and thou hast increased thy riches. Thy heart is lifted up because of thy riches. Therefore thus saith the Lord God, because thou hast set the heart as the heart of God, behold, therefore I will bring strangers upon thee, terrible of the nation, and they shall draw their swords against thy beauty and thy wisdom, and they shall defy thy brightness. They shall bring thee down to the pit, and thou shalt die the death of them that are slain in the midst of the sea. Will thou say that to them that slay thee, that I am God? Thou shalt be a man and no God in the hands of them that slay thee. Thou shalt die the death of the uncircumcised by the hands of stranger. I have spoken it, said the Lord. Moreover, the word of now, that's the man in the throne. That's the Castro, the Hitler, the burnt throne. Why is that man describing there that the Antichrist, when he comes, he's going to be a very wise, absolute power, have a lot of authority and things like that. The dragon give him power. This person we saw in here, this is the person on the throne. He's wise, very wise in the things of earth and so on, earthly wisdom. But look at behind the throne now, the man behind the throne. Look at it. Verse 11, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation to the king of Tyrus. Now, we know that the prince, and this is the king. Now, the prince is the son of the king. Satan is the king, and he's the son, the guy on the throne. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation to the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord, thou sealest a son full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. See, Satan is perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden in the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, the carbuncle, the gold, the workmanship of thy tabret. Thy pipe was prepared in the day that thou was created. Thou art the anointed cherub. Satan is a cherubim. Cherub is short for cherubim that covered. I have said thee so. Thou was bound the holy mountain. Remember, we saw him there in the garden of Eden, a God. Thou was walk up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou was perfect in thy ways. The thou was created until iniquity was found in thee by the multitude of thy merchandise that was filled the midst of thee with violence. Thou hast sinned, therefore I'll cast thee out as profane out of the mountain of God. I'll destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire and so on. Thy heart is lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou was corrupted by wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I have cast thee down to the ground. I'll lay thee before kings, and they shall behold thee. Thou hast defiled the sanctuary by thy multitude of thy iniquity, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore, I will bring thee forth as fire from the midst of thee, and I will devour thee, and I'll bring thee to the ashes upon the earth in the sight of them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall narrowly be astonished at thee, and thou shalt be a terror, and shall never be any more. So we see that same picture play out here in the book of Revelation, the dragon giving power. We see this picture in Ezekiel, the man in the throne, very wise. You see seven heads, universal wisdom. 10 crowns, absolute power. You see that? And they describe him a bear, a lion, a kind of savage type person. So we saw that. Go back there. Look at 2 Chronicles, war. 2 Chronicles. And look at something here. Go forth to kill and be killed. Go forth to kill and be killed. 2 Chronicles, we saw a little picture this here in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. We saw a picture of it here. War. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And let's pick it up. Let's pick it up in the 20th verse. Combined army coming towards Jehoshaphat. And he don't know what to be crowd to God, and the spirit fall upon wall Jehoshaphat. And he tell him, this is what you do. So he gave him the prescription for success, for victory. So he went out and he did that. But let's pick it up at the 20th verse, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. War, the red horse, war. Go make war. And this is a sort of picture. Go forth to kill and be killed. Combine army coming. Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20. And they rose up early in the morning, and they went out into the wilderness of Tekoa, and they went forth. Jehoshaphat stood and said, Hear you, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe your Lord, your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophet, so shall you prosper. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord that they should praise the beauty of his holiness. And they went out before the armies to say, praise God for his mercy endured forever. When they began to sing praises, the Lord set ambushment against the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir. And they went out against Judah, and they were smitten. And when the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, they utterly slay and destroy them, and made an end of the inhabitants of Seir. Everyone helped to destroy the other. And so they went out, they come out against Judah, but then they end up fighting and killing each other. So he tell them when they open that second seal, they see that red horse, go for that, make war, be killed, go fight, get killed, and be killed, and kill yourself also. Look at that, they begin to sing praise, verse 22, and praise the Lord that set ambushment against the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, and which come out against Judah, and they were smitten. Now they didn't raise anything, all they do, they were singing praise God for he is good, and there this combined army out there killing each other. Look at verse 23. And the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir and utterly slay and destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, everyone helped to destroy them. And they went out and take all the spoil and so on. Look at the book of Luke. The red horse, war. After the white horse, that false church plunged straight into hell. Look at Luke chapter 21. Is Luke in the Bible? Just want to make sure we need B.I.B. Second seal. First one, white horse. Red horse. Hallelujah. Look at Luke chapter 21. And look at this. Pick it up at verse 22. I have a red lady edition. Pick it up at verse 22. And these be the days of vengeance. All things shall be written, shall be fulfilled. Woe unto them that have a child, and woe unto them that give suck in those days, for there shall be great distress in the land, the wrath will come upon the people. They shall fall by the edge of sword, they shall fall by the edge of sword, the red horse, fall by the edge of sword, and they shall led away captive into nations, and Jerusalem shall be trundled down by the Gentiles until the time of the Gentile be fulfilled. Look at this, look at verse 25. And there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nation with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. When they said the sea and the waves roaring, what do you think you're talking about? There's war between nations, fighting, killing and getting each other killed. Look at that. Look at verse 25. And the signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nation with perplexity, the sea and the wave. And what taking place in the Middle East between Iraq and Iran, and all this fighting out there. Libya and Egypt and all that fighting taking place, fighting the sea and the wave roaring. Men heart failing them for the fear, for looking after those things which coming upon the earth, for the power of heaven shall be shaken. And then as you see these things, the Son of Man coming to the clouds with great one glory. Look at verse 28. When these things begin to come to pass, look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth near. What redemption he's talking about? We get part one, we didn't get part two yet. When we are born again, we get first part of our redemption. We get a new spirit, we didn't get a new body. He said, when all these wars are taking place, lift up your head, your redemption draweth near. Part two, we're going to get our new body on the last day. When these things begin to happen, look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth near. Your redemption of your body, we're going to get a new body. So that's what's going to happen, the red horse. Go back to Revelation. Chapter 6. And let's see another horse. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Revelation chapter 6. And look at verse 5. What are we seeing there? What are we seeing in verse 5? When he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see. And behold, lo, a black horse, and he that sat upon it had a pair of balance in his hand. And a voice in the midst of the four beasts said, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. See that thou hurt not the oil nor the wine. Farming. After this white horse, this false church, everybody packed the church, this now false gospel. After that is war, blood, red horse. After this is farming. Well, what happened in farming? Look at it. When he had opened the third seal, I heard the third voice saying, come and see. And now he tell John, come and see this John, come and see. Oh no, notice he having a vision, seeing, come and see. He said, behold a black horse, and he that sat upon it, he that, notice he, notice something else, Look at this little passage of Revelation. Those who have ears to hear, let them hear. Go back up to verse 2. Go back up to verse 2. Look at this. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon it had a crown of golden head, and went forth conquering to conquer. Now notice, the horse is white. They didn't say what the rider was like, whether he's black or white. The horse is what changed. When he opened the second seal, behold, they come and see. And they went another, look at this, and they went out a horse that was red. So they changed the color of the horse. The horse is white. This horse is a red horse. When they come down here, the fifth verse, when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third voice say, come and see. And behold, a black horse. He that sat upon, notice he all the time. The same he, but different horses. A white horse. Notice the horse color change. The horse, white horse, red horse, black horse. Can you read? When he had opened the third seal, the third said, come and see. And behold, a black horse. And he that sat upon had a pair of balance in his hand, and heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of wheat for a penny. Well, somebody said, a penny? Well, wait a minute. It means things are going to get that expensive. He give a parable here, but he said, well, you see, a penny? That's a whole day wage just to get something to eat. What you get for a whole day? Won't you get $100 a day? Well, look at this. Look at this. Watch this. Look at, he give this parable here. He give this parable here. The kingdom of heaven was like, and he went forth to hire laborers in this vineyard and so on. And he said, when they agreed to give him a penny a day, remember that parable? Give him a penny a day. So it's a day wages to buy some food. So what do you get a whole day? Look at it, a penny. If you look at that one, you know, he gave this parable, you know, when he, a penny's worth, a penny, used a penny, went out to hire laborers. When he hire one, he see one, he give him a penny, go hire the next guy and so on, he hire. Hallelujah. If you could see that one, it's here, a penny's worth, a penny's worth. So you got a penny's worth. So then you read this here, say, well, this is a big deal, a penny worth. Look at it, look at verse 6. I heard a voice saying unto him, your four be saying, a measure of wheat for a penny. Well, a penny is what you get for a whole, when you look at the parable there, a penny is what you get for a whole day work. So things get very expensive in a farming. After a war, they destroy the economy. Everything gets very expensive. So the law of supply and demand kicking is only a small supply. So the demand is great and the price is going very high. After a war, they destroy the economy. Look at this. Watch this. Look at this. Look at 2 Kings. Look what happened in a famine. They say a penny doesn't sound like big deal. That's what you get for a whole pay. Say when he hired us, he went out to hire labor, he gave him a penny a day. The third hour we went to hire and he gave him a penny a day. And the sixth hour we hire a penny a day. That's a day wage. So things get that hard. That you have to take a whole day wage to get something to eat. Look at 2 Kings. Look at a picture of a famine. 2 Kings chapter 6. Look at what you're playing with. When after there's a war, there's farming. When there's farming, brother, you can't get another tea and people die. You see, create the war destroy the economy, people flee from the country and they die, sometimes in fleeing. And we read a while ago, war that you've not been winter, that you're not been with a child, you're given suck in those days, you have to run with your babies and all that. Yeah, they destroy the economy, so nothing. So a penny worth to buy some food. Look at this picture here. 2 Kings chapter 6. Look at this. Verse 24. And it came to pass after this thing that Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, gathered all his hosts and went up and besieged Samaria. Samaria is the capital of Israel. What's this? There was a great famine in Samaria. And behold, they besieged it until an ass's head was sold for 80 pieces of silver, and a fourth part of calf dung was sold for 5 pieces of silver. They're selling doodoo for money. Things get said, they besieged the city, nothing could go out and come in because of the war. So that's what happened over there. After the white horse, the red horse is war. After that's famine come. Look at it. Look at verse 26. And the king of Israel passed upon the walls and cried, a woman cried unto him, saying, help me, my lord, O king. And he said, if the Lord do not help thee, when shall I help thee? Out of the barn floor or out of the winepress? And the king said unto her, what aileth thee? And she answered and said, this woman said unto me, give me my son that we may eat him today, and we need my son tomorrow. And we boil my son in a famine. It destroyed the community, nothing coming. So there are no food, they're eating each other's children. They boil her son. Next day, no, we have time to hand up her son. She don't want to hand up her son to eat. So that's what happened in a famine. So when you say a penny's worth, it seems like a penny, so what? Oh, that's a day wage. That's a day wage. A penny's worth. Can you see that? Go back. Go back to the next. Go back to the next one. Let's see the next one. Hallelujah. Look at the other one. Look at verse 7. When he had opened the fourth seal, I heard a voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. And look and behold, a pale horse. Notice the horse is what changing the colors all the time. Notice the horse is what changing it. A white horse, a red horse, a black horse, a pale horse. What kind of horse is a pale horse? Well, the book of Zechariah says it's a bay horse. It's a reddish brown. A pale horse. Kind of dull looking, ashy gray kind of color. And look and behold, a pale horse, and the name that sat upon him was Death and Hell. Well, after the famine, after the war, a lot of people are going to get killed. After the famine, more people are going to get killed. So Death and Hell. Notice Death first and Hell after. Why? Death killed the body and Hell waiting for the spirit. It's the body they kill. So Death killed the body and Hell kept the spirit. So look at it. Behold, a pale horse, and the name of him that sat upon it was called Death, and Hell followed him. And the power was given unto him over a fourth part of the earth to kill with the sword and with hunger, sword and with hunger, war and hunger, farming, things expensive, can't afford to buy the food, hunger, with death and with the beasts of the earth. Can you see that? Can you see that? Death and Hell. Death and Hell. Look at Revelation. Look at Revelation chapter 20. Death and Hell. Death and Hell. Revelation chapter 20. Notice death always comes first and hell falls. Death always first. Death kill you. Death kill the body. And hell receive the spirit. When you die physically, they kill the body, the spirit leave the body. If you're not saved, you're going down. If you're saved, you're going up. Revelation chapter 20, and let's pick it up at the 11th verse. Death and hell. The first horse, white. Second horse, red. Third horse, black. Fourth horse, a bay horse or pale horse. Death and hell. They kill you with starvation, hunger, famine. Revelation chapter 20. And let's pick it up at verse 11. Revelation chapter 20. Let's pick it up at verse 11. And see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. And I saw a great white throne and him that sat upon it, whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged of the things which were written in the book according to his works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. They were judged every man according to his works. Death and hell. Notice death always first. Death and hell were cast in the lake of fire. This is the second death. Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast in the lake of fire. Notice death is a personality. And hell is a personality. They cast them in the lake of fire. Notice that. Look at that. Look at that word. The sea gave up the dead. Three sets of people. Who is the sea? Who is the sea? The sea gave up the dead, which were in it. Death and hell delivered the dead which were in them. Every man judged according to his work. Look at it. Death and hell were cast in the lake of fire. So death is a personality. Hell is a personality. Everyone who was not found written in the book of life cast in the sea. Who is the sea? Who is the sea? The sea was cast. Who is the sea? Look at Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 21. The sea give up the dead. Who is the sea? Somebody said the people who drown in the sea. You must be crazy. You drown in the sea. The minute you die, your spirit leave your body. You drown in the sea. The minute you die, your spirit leave your body. And if you save, the spirit going up. If you're not saved, the spirit going down. The body stay here not. You die, that who die in the sea? You must be out of your mind. That's not what you're talking about. Look at it. The sea give up the dead. Who is the sea? Luke chapter 21, look at verse 25. And they shall see signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the wave roaring. The sea and nations around the world, in Asia and in Africa and in Europe, in the Americas, who know not Christ. Those folks who know not Christ, out of here. The sea and the wave, the sea give up the dead first. All those people who never received Christ the Lord, the sea give up the dead. Out of here. Who does the sea? People who never received Christ, they're worshiping some other religion, the sea give up the dead. Look at Isaiah chapter 57. Look at Isaiah. Keep your mark on Revelation. We're going back there. Isaiah chapter 57. And look what he said here. Isaiah chapter 57. Look at two verses, 20 and 21. The sea give up the dead. Look at these two verses. But the wicked are like the troubled sea, when it cannot rest, whose waters cast about as mire and dirt. There is no peace, said God, for the wicked. The sea. People all around the world who never received Jesus as Lord and Savior, worship somebody else. The sea. Look at it. The wicked are like the troubled sea, when it cannot rest, whose waters are cast like mire and dirt. Look at something else. Look at Revelation. Look at Revelation chapter 17. The sea. Revelation 17. Look at the 15th verse. The sea. People on earth. The living dead. The sea give up the dead. Hallelujah. The sea give up the dead. Look at it. Look at verse 15. And he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the host sitteth, are peoples, and multitudes, and nations, and tongues. The sea. Look at that 15th verse again. The sea give up the dead. He said unto me, the waters that thou sawest, where the host sitteth, are peoples, in Africa, in Asia, in Europe, in the Americas, all the islands of the sea, and multitudes, and nations, the sea, and nations, and tongues, all different languages, and tongues, the sea. Death, give up the dead. Who is death? Death, give up the dead. Who is death? Revelation, chapter 13. Hallelujah. Revelation, chapter 13. Get something to write with. The sea give up the dead. Death give up the dead. Who is death? Death have people. Death. They belong to death. They're dead. Hallelujah. Those people, the sea give up the dead. They could have an opportunity to be saved, but they never received Jesus Christ, so they went on. These people, no way. No way they could be saved. Look at this. Revelation 13, look at verse 8. And all they that dwell upon the earth who worship him, whose names were not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So their name was never in the book of life. Okay, what you do? They're dead. The sea give up the dead. Death give up the dead. Look at the next one. Look at Revelation 17. And look at the 8th verse. Revelation 8 verse. Never. Only whose name is in the book of life. Never. From the foundation of the world. You see, those folk then they see their name in the book of life. When they come towards the end of the time, they never receive Christ. They take it out to the book of life and they put it into the books. There's only one book of life. You see, those who does this see, they never receive Christ. All through their life, had an opportunity to receive. They never receive. They worship in somebody else. So when they die, they take the name of the book of life and put it there. These folks, the name was never in the book. Look at it. Revelation 17, look at verse 8. The beast that thou sawest and was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, and shall go unto perdition, and they that dwell upon the earth shall wonder whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was, that is, and is yet. Never, from the foundation of the world, never. Their name was never in the book. Those people in the sea, their name in the book, they come in here, their name see, they never received Jesus. When they die, they take the name out of the book and put it in the books. But these folks, they was never there. You see, there's hope for some folks over there who worship and already hear this and they want to come to our side. Fine. When they didn't receive Jesus, they take it out of the book of life and they put it over in the books. You see that? But these folks said their name was never in the book. Never. Never. Dead. Dead. Then those folks, look at here. Look at here. Look at Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews chapter 6. Look at this. Hebrews chapter 6. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 6. Walking through the Bible, looking at Revelation, the sea give up the dead. Death give up the dead. Death. No room for it. Never. Your name was never in the book of life. In that day, many are going to say to me, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied, cast out? They said, depart from me. I never. You don't say, I don't know you. I never knew you. Never. Name was never in the book. Look at this here. Then there's this here now. Look at this. There's the next set of folks. Hebrews 6, verse 1. Therefore, leaving the principles and the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not lay again the foundation of repentance from dead work and the faith towards God, of the doctrines of baptism, of the laying on of hands, of the resurrection from the dead, and of eternal judgment. This we will do if God permit. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and tasted the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted the good word of God and the power of the world to come, if they should fall away, to renew again unto repentance, seeing that they crucified to themselves the Son of Man afresh and put him to open shame. So these people commit the unpardonable sin? No way. Those folks, before we look at their name, was never in the book. These names were in the book of life, but they commit the unpardonable sin? No way. Dead. You're walking around dead. Nowhere to go. You could fast and pray and do whatever you want. Nothing doing. Nothing doing. Hebrews 10. Commit the unpardonable sin. Hebrews chapter 10. Put your finger in the 26th verse. Put your finger in the 26th verse. Hebrews chapter 10. Put your finger in the 26th verse. And see what God is saying to us. Hebrews chapter 10, look at verse 26. For if we sin willingly, after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remain no more sacrifices for sin. Willingly, you know better. You know better. Willingly. Look at it. For if we sin willingly after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaining no more sacrifice for sin. Commit the unpardonable sin. Look at 1 John. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. The sea give up the dead, yes. Death give up the dead. Hell give up the dead. 1st John chapter 5. 1st John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. And let's see what God is saying to us there. Look at two verses. Look at 16 and 17. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for him that sin not unto death. There's a sin unto death. I do not say that you should pray for it. You can't pray for it. There's a sin unto death. Pray for it. Look at verse 17. All unrighteousness is sin. There's a sin not unto death, but there's a sin unto death. Look at that 16 verse again. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for him that sin not to death. There's a sin unto death, You can't pray for it. You can't pray for it. I say you can't pray for it. There's nothing you can do. Let's close with this. The book of Jude. Small book before Revelation. Look what Jude said. Look what Jude said. Jude, a small book before Revelation. The sea give up the dead, fine. Death give up the dead, yeah. Those in hell who die without Christ and they go to hell, give up the dead. Both death and hell are personalities. They will be cast in the lake of fire at the end. Look at this in the book of Jude. Chapter 1 is a one chapter book. Pick up verse 11. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain and run greedily after the errors of Balaam for reward and perish in the gainsaying of God. These are spots in your face of charity. When they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear, clouds they are without water. How clouds gonna have no water? Clouds are water. Clouds are condensed water suspended. Clouds they are without water. They're spirit with no bodies. Look at it. Clouds are with water, carried about with winds, trees whose fruit withered, without fruits, twice dead, physically, spiritually, dead, twice dead, plucked up by the roots, rearing waves of the sea, forming out of their own shame, wandering stars, so who's reserved the blackness of darkness forever? Wow. Wow, I wish we could go some more. Wandering stars reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Nowhere to go. Nowhere to go. Walking through the Bible. Revelation. Glory to God. Amen. Amen and amen.
Wow. Wow, this is something, you know, because, I mean, this book of Revelation is something else, you know, but I mean, it's true, you know, we just have to be very careful, you know, because at the end of it, it is so much, you know, and when you look at it, you know, and God put this word there for us to be able to know. That's why he tell us in his word for us to study. You know, you have to study and you have to try the spirit to know. You know, because right now in these last days, they out there and you have to know.
Yeah.
You understand? You have to know because at the end of it, it's about where you going. You can't just accept anything and everything right here is in the Bible and it tells you what to look for. It tells you what to look for. And at the end of the day, just make sure, you know, you know, you know, you know, you know, you know. And another thing, search your heart. Make sure your heart is right. I say it over and over again, make sure your heart is right. Because sometimes that heart is tricky. You know, sometimes we have things that's in our heart that we have not released. You know, something else that I want to say, you know, we're in the body of Christ and, you know, we're still holding on to envy, grudges. You know, somebody said something that you dislike and you're holding all of that in your heart and your heart is getting hardened. You understand? So search your heart to make sure your heart is right. You know, and sometimes we have to put pride aside, you know, and go to somebody and ask them, you know, could you forgive me for this or for that? You know, because all of that is important at the end of the day. You know, without that, without unforgiveness, you know, if you don't forgive, your prayer is not going anywhere. You could forget it. You could pray all you want. It's not going anywhere. You know, so search your heart. Amen.
Hallelujah. We want to give those that are listening an opportunity to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. The Bible says, not my wish that any should perish. He doesn't want anybody going to hell. Hell was not made for you, but hell was made for the devil and his angels. You don't have to go to hell. All you have to do is to say yes. Not to fill out any form, quit your job, leave your husband, your wife, abandon your kids, give up your apartment, change your name, fill out a form, bring some money. All you have to do is to say yes. Paul on the Damascus Road, all he say, who are thou, Lord? I'm Jesus. What will thou have me to go in the city? I'll tell you what thou wantest to do. When Stephen and Ananias came to me, lay hands on him and said, Brother Saul. So you could receive that by saying yes. Be part of the saved. So if you're already saved, stand proxy for somebody who is not saved. But if you're not saved, then stand for yourself. Repeat these words and meet from the bottom of your heart. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
You said in your holy word.
You said in your holy word.
Whosoever come to me.
Who should ever come to me.
I will no way cast out.
I will no way cast out.
But I'll take them in.
But I'll take them in.
So I come to you.
So I come to you.
You didn't cast me out.
You didn't cast me out.
But you took me in.
But you took me in.
And I thank you.
And I thank you.
Romans 10.
Romans 10.
Verse 13.
Verse 13.
Whosoever call upon the name of the Lord.
Who should ever call upon the name of the Lord.
Shall be saved.
Shall be saved.
So I call upon upon your name.
So I call upon your name.
So I'm now saved.
So I'm now saved.
Romans 10. Verses 9 and 10. The mouth confession is made unto salvation. But with the heart man believe it unto righteousness.
I
confess with my mouth. The Lord Jesus. That he died. Went to hell. Spent 3 days. And 3 nights. Just for me. Because I confess that with my mouth. And I believe that in my heart. I'm now saved.
I now become
the righteousness of God. In Christ.
Second Corinthians 5:21.
Jesus, you represent me in heaven. And I will. Represent you on earth.
Jesus,
I thank you.
For
what you did for me.
On Calvary.
Shedding your blood. To redeem me. From the curse of the law. Spiritual death. Poverty. And sickness.
Satan.
You no longer my
you
Lord.
You are no longer my Lord.
Jesus Christ. Is my Lord. And my Savior. I'll live for him.
I'll serve him.
I'll study his word. I'll be a good example.
For all to see.
And I thank you. In your name I pray.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Christianity is not passive but active. Get busy with the things of God. Get your Bible and start reading your Bible. Start with the Gospel according to John. You say that you should study to show yourself approved unto God. Start with the Gospel according to John. You speak about love more on the other. So get with him. Read the first chapter. Read in the morning. Read at lunchtime. Again at bedtime. Take your time. Don't try to read the whole Bible in one day. Take your time and read. Ask God to lead you to a church that will feed you spiritually. Don't go to a church because your friends are going there because there's a church down the block. Of course, you don't believe that. May not be so. Ask him to lead you and submit to that authority, and God will bless you with these things. Amen. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time that you have given us. Thank you for the opportunities and the privilege you give us. Thank you for all these things that we give you. All the praise, all the honor, and all the glory, Lord, because all belong to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
And amen.
Good night.
You have been listening to Pastor Randolph Ferdinand, teachings from the Word. To get a copy of this teaching or any of the other series, call 347-533-4271. 347-533-4271. Like us on Facebook.